Nolan, if you could, Nolan, if you could go back two slides to that date night slide. I got to say this, or I'll be thinking about it from that one. Now, I'm not sure. That looks to me like a baby, a child escaping the building through the window. So I just want you to know, if you bring your child, there are no windows in the children's space, and no child will escape through the window.
Okay? This is something you don't have to worry about at home.
This, that, there you go. If this might happen at home, but if you bring your child here, that's the baby escaping in order to get here. That's what, okay, thank you, Billy. That's how much your baby wants to come to date night babysitting, that he or she would escape through his home window. Okay, enough of that. You can go back to the, welcome, good to see you. I think I know most of you, if not all of you. I'm Pastor Randy, and we are going to go deep into the book of Colossians today. As we continue this verse-by-verse study of the book of Colossians. It's titled this because it was written while the author, the Apostle Paul, was in prison. So this is one of the letters. He had time on his hands, I suppose. So he wrote these significant letters that made it into the Bible. Here's where I want to begin. I want to begin by sharing something with you that I came upon this week. Just a few days ago, I heard a pretty well-known philosopher, he's passed away now, by the name of Dr. Dallas Willard. Some of you may read his stuff. He's a Christian. He's a good fella, brilliant fella. He taught at USC, University of Southern California, and he, I recently was listening to him speak, and something that he said, it struck me. What Dr. Willard said, it wasn't particularly earth-shattering, it was just really good. And I think it's a springboard into our study today. In other words, if we don't deal with what I'm about to say, then it will be more difficult for us to study the supremacy of Christ in our lives. So here's what Dr. Willard said. He said, The fundamental reality on the teaching that prevails in our culture is the physical world. Okay, so what that means is that you are your body. That's the predominant teaching in the culture that we live in. What you take into your physical body and what you produce, like your output, your work, and how you appear are it. That's it. That's reality in the physical world, in the culture that we live in. You are your body. So it's no wonder that so many of us spend so much time working on, not me, but on your body. Because this is how we define ourselves. We, the human race, think of ourselves almost exclusively in physical terms. So you're defined by the flesh that covers your bone structure and your blood and your guts. So it goes something like this. You are your DNA, or you are the genes that your parents passed down to you. You are that physical gray matter, your brain. You know, you are your brain and your DNA and your body. Our culture, in fact, has trouble defining people in any other way besides in physical terms. Apart from that, we have trouble culturally differentiating between people. I'll give you an example, and that is this technology, this controversial technology of facial recognition. Facial recognition, and that technology is just another example of how the physical self in our culture, the physical self is the true self. And that is how we define one another and differentiate between one another. It's the physical self. And so it's no wonder that we haven't solved problems like race and gender and tribalism and nationalism, because we define one another merely in physical terms. Now, in a very different camp, this would be Christian thought, Orthodox Christian thought, in a very different camp, this is a Christian ethic that I will now share with you. We are spiritual beings. We're more than just the flesh and blood and guts and DNA and gray matter. We are, in Christian thinking, we are spiritual beings. I want to share with you an easy definition of spirit. Spirit. You ever wonder what that is? Spirit. I've drawn from several people, Wayne Grudem and Dr. Willard here, but what does it mean? What is the definition of spirit? Well, spirit, I'm glad you asked, spirit is unbodily, like non-material, but beyond that, unbodily personal power. Unbodily personal power. In other words, your spirit is not so connected to your physical body that it's subservient to your physical body. One day your physical body will die, will rot, will go away, but your spirit will continue to thrive because your spirit is an unbodily power, yes, but personal power. In other words, it's not just some power force that's going on in the universe. You are a person. You are a spiritual being. You remember Jesus went to the well, and there was a woman at the well, and she was a Samaritan woman, and they had this great dialogue about spiritual things, and he said to her, do you remember what he said? He said, God is spirit. It's John 4. You can look it up later. God is spirit, and those who worship him will worship him in spirit and in truth. God is spirit. God is unbodily personal power. He does not have, God does not have a body. We'll get to Jesus here in a little bit, but God does not have a body. Now, he manifests himself in different ways, in different forms. He has shown up throughout history in different forms. So I hesitate to say he's completely immaterial, but he is unbodily, and he is a personal power. He's not just some power force that we can plug into in the universe and draw from. That's not Christian thinking. That's thought, but that's not Christian thinking. According to Christian belief, he has personhood. So we have God existing in three persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. I'm just giving you Orthodox Christian thinking, because some of us, we need to catch up. We need to realize, what does the Bible say about spirit? God is spirit, but not just some nebulous power. He is the personhood of God. God exists in three persons, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and each person is fully God, and yet there is one God. The mystery of the Trinity. As I said, God the Father has no body. And in this culture that we live in, everything is defined by the physical. And so would you be willing, if you live in that camp, would you be willing to say that by the culture's definition, there is no God? Because we measure everything by the material, And God is unbodily, he's immaterial, and so there must not be a God. Well, I don't think any of us would doubt the reality of his existence. And yet he has no body. Don't ask science to prove God. Don't get into an argument trying to defend God with science. Science deals with the physical, the material. I love science, but it deals with the physical, the material, and God is spirit. So if we try to meld, because the culture that we live in and the predominant thought within the culture that we live in, the physical world, it's a reality. I'm not denying it. I'm saying it's not the whole story. And then we've got Christian thought, which includes the spiritual world. So we have two worlds. We have the physical and we have the spirit, two kingdoms. So God is spirit, and God acts in the physical world, in the spiritual world, and God's actions determine his kingdom. We talk about the kingdom of our Lord, the kingdom of God, and what we're really talking about is the realm of God's reign, his moving, his working. We call this the kingdom of God. And then there is the kingdom of the world. And there is a separation, and yet there is an overlap. I think you know what I mean by that. There is a separation, the kingdom of the world, the physical world, the kingdom of God, the spiritual world, and yet there is an overlap. And we live in that almost, but not yet, being pulled out of the kingdom of the world, but not quite fully invested in the kingdom of God. We live in that tension of those two worlds. And so what do we pray? One of the most famous prayers that's ever been that the Christians pray, and it goes like this: may your kingdom come. Right? Jesus taught us to pray, may your kingdom come, may your will be done. We see on earth as it is in heaven. What are we doing? We're acknowledging that there's this physical world and that there's the spiritual world. And we're saying, God, would you infuse your kingdom world into our physical world? But probably more than anything, when I pray that, perhaps when you pray that, what I'm saying is, God, may your kingdom come in my own personal space. Would you invade my space? Would you fill me? May your kingdom come in my own life and living. So culture tells us to seek the physical kingdom exclusively, the kingdom of this world, which in some ways is at odds with, in tension with, the antithesis of the spiritual kingdom of God. In Matthew 6, Jesus invites us, there's a part A and there's a part B. Jesus invites us to, he says, do not be anxious about this world or about your life. Do not be anxious about your life. But then part B, seek first the kingdom of God. See, Jesus is, he's not denying the physical world or the spiritual. He's dealing with both. He says, don't worry about, and he's speaking of your physical life. Don't be anxious about your life, but seek first the kingdom of God. Now, interestingly, he uses that word, seek, and maybe I'm splitting hairs here, but he doesn't say find it. It's on you to find it. Jesus was very, very exact with his words throughout his life. There's no ambiguity about what he's saying here. He says, seek first the kingdom of God, and then later on in his talk, we call it Matthew chapter 7, he says this, he says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. So now we got three three parts to this overall philosophy that Jesus is inviting us into. He says, first of all, don't be anxious about the physical world. And honestly, most of us would be like, if we could just accomplish that one thing, I think we would be pretty satisfied. So part A, there's three parts. Part A, don't be anxious about the physical world. And then part B says, seek first the kingdom of God. First meaning priority before anything else. Seek first the kingdom of God. And then the third part is, and if you seek it, you will find it. It's almost as though Jesus is saying, it will find you. Am I living in God's will? Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God, and you will find it. You will find yourself there. What do you do when you seek something? What do you do when you seek something? I'll tell you a little story. A few years ago, I had lost a USB, a thumb drive, and it had like years of photos of our kids. And I'm not even sure for a while I even told Lydia that I'd lost this thing, but I lost a really significant, and because I don't have a good system of backing things up, I was like, I'm not sure that I have those pictures anywhere else. Again, I'm asking, what do you do when you seek something, when you're seeking something? Because Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God. So I looked for it everywhere. That's what you do when you're seeking something. You look for it everywhere. Seek first the kingdom of God. So I looked for this USB, this thumb drive, in every nook, in every cranny, and behind the couch, and under the chair, and in the cabinets. I mean, there were years worth of photos. And so I told myself, I was kind of worried, and for a couple of years, I would tell myself, it was really gone for about 2 years, I would tell myself, keep your eye open for that thumb drive, and one day you will find it. And lo and behold, after 2 years of just having that mindset of I'm seeking this thumb drive. After a couple of years of that, one day I was inspecting a pair of boots in my closet that I hadn't worn in years, and I turned it upside down, and there it was. The thumb drive fell out of the boot, and I had found it. What do you do when you seek something? You look for it everywhere. In every aspect of life. At every turn and every moment in life, you are seeking the kingdom of God. And guess what? Jesus says, if you seek it, you will find it. So the voice of the modern culture, in this modern day context, is telling you that you are defined in a physical context. And that's it. And so it makes sense if you live under that ethic that you are a physical being and that is how you are defined. Then it makes sense to go to the gym and go on long runs and skip beer and Doritos and get a good education because you want to fill your head with knowledge. And then what do? Then you start working on the physical world around you with a big house and an important job and money in the bank and so on because you are a physical being and you're working on the physical world around you and you feed that. And we're not going to raise our hands, but every one of us struggles with the exclusive and yet the exclusive nature of that way of thinking. I was going to say damning nature of that lifestyle because it just kills you. But there's another voice that speaks into this topic, the voice of Jesus. He says, you are spirit. You're not just a physical body. You are a non-material, personal power or force. You are a spiritual being. And so today, in the passage today, Paul preaches a greater reality than just the physical world, a rich truth. And the interesting thing about it is, in doing this, he doesn't talk a lot about you and about me and how we're all that. What he does is, because he's talking to Christians, he talks about Jesus and the implications of the supremacy of Christ, the implications regarding my own life, regarding your own life, are enormous. So let's look at this passage now. By the way, what we're reading today is considered by many to be the most important Christological passage. In other words, the most important passage dealing with Jesus Christ and his supremacy in all of the New Testament. So we've landed today on a really significant theological work. So as I read it, hang on every words, on every word rather. Colossians 1, verses 15 through 20. Here's what it says. The Son, Jesus Christ, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him, and all things have been created for him. Verse 17, he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, in the Son, in Jesus, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. The word of the Lord, for which I give thanks. Okay, these six verses, again, considered to be the most important Christ-honoring verses in the entire New Testament, they give us six big ideas about Jesus. How does that relate to what I just said about our being spiritual beings? The reason this is it dovetails into what I said earlier, is that the Christian thought, Christian teaching is this: when Jesus dwells in us, then we have the power, the ability to live in the kingdom of God, to say, may the kingdom of God reside in me, around me. I want to live in the kingdom of God. That happens with Jesus moving in, dwelling in you as your Lord, as your Savior. So today, six big ideas on Jesus found in this passage. The first one is this, and we're not going to project these. In fact, I want you to, if you would just go back now and show the passage that we're reading, okay? And there are two slides. First of all, first big idea, you might want to write these down. There's six of them. First one, We look at the sun. When we look at the sun, we see God. Now, I say this, and some of you might hear it as though, well, yeah, of course. But I tell you, within the church, here in the valley, I think other places I've lived as well, but here in the valley, people that have some sense of who Jesus is still don't realize that that according to the Bible, and if you don't believe the Bible, that's one thing, but according to the Bible, Jesus was and is fully, completely God. He's not junior God. He's not less than God. Jesus is God. In this passage in verse 15, it says, the Son is the image of the invisible God. And go to verse 19. It says this, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. You can go back to the other passage now, the first screen. What is this saying? It's saying that all of God, God the Spirit, God the Father, who unbodily personal power, all of God was manifested, is manifested in bodily form. Jesus Christ. The Son, according to this passage, is completely God. The Son, Jesus Christ, according to this passage, is supreme in every way. We know that God is spirit. We say things, we think that the Old Testament says this, and it does. We think that the Old Testament, so we sometimes say this, well, no one has ever seen God and lived. You can't look at God. We remember that story where Moses wanted, I want to see you, God, and God said, you can't see me and live. So I'm gonna hide you in the cleft of a rock, and I'm gonna cover you with my hand, and I'll walk by, and you might just like in the corner of your eye just see the image, the shadow of me going by, but you're not gonna see me because no one can see God and live. And yet Jesus is God made flesh. The big word that we use is Jesus is incarnate. He incarnated himself. He took on human flesh. The Word, this is out of John chapter 1, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So what do we have? We have God who is an unbodily personal power determining to take on flesh and blood and enter into our realm. Why did he do that? Move into our neighborhood, as Eugene Peterson says. Well, why did he do that? The amazing mystery of the gospel is the incarnation of Christ. That God, without giving up being God, he became a man. Tim Keller writes a lot about this truth that I'm about to speak, and that is that if you think on it, God cared so much about the brokenness and the sickness of humanity that he determined to enter into it. There is no greater example of empathy in the existence of the universe than God looking down on the brokenness of humanity and not turning his back, but rather entering into, subjecting himself to the brokenness of humanity by becoming the God-man. And you should understand that in the ancient world in which John, in chapter 1, writes that passage, that God, or the Word, became flesh and dwelt among us. In the ancient world, that was scandalous. It still is, in fact, but that was scandalous that God would humble himself. In that day, in that way of thinking, but perhaps in our way of thinking as well, the idea is that God is, he's other than, which he is. He's transcendent. He's non-physical. which I don't think I would use that exact phrase, but he is away from us. He is apart from us. The idea that he would sully himself, get himself dirty, that he would sully himself by becoming a human being, that he would humble himself, that he would take on the role of a servant. As it says in Philippians that he would not consider heaven something to be grasped or held on to, but that he would bother with us is scandalous. And it speaks to the love and the compassion that the Father has for you, has for us. That he would enter into our realm, that he would bother with us. I suppose in my silly, limited way of thinking, he could have just started over again, I suppose. But he determined out of a compassion for us to bother with us. You've heard me say this before. The greatest hurdle that has ever been cleared in the history of the universe was when God determined, I will sacrifice my son on the cross for humanity. I will do that. I will send God the Son, Jesus Christ. I will send my son to the earth to die a sinner's death on the cross for the sake of humanity. I will subject, God determined, I will subject myself, Jesus, out of obedience to the Father, I will subject myself to the brokenness of humanity out of a love for us. We look at the Son, and we see God. Now, one of the grand implications of this truth is that the hope that I have, the hope that we have as Christians is not something that comes from within us. I will better myself. I've been a terrible person. I've been a jerk. I've been a loser. I've been a thief. I've been a crook, but within myself, I will better myself. No, Christian thought, that's not where we live at all. Christian thought says that our hope comes from the Lord. That Jesus, he wasn't just some human being representing God on our behalf. No, he is presenting God because he is God. He doesn't just represent God. He presents God to us. He is our hope from without. God moved into our realm. And so Jesus is this point of contact between divine reality and human life. Verse 19 again says, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ. That's scandalous and beautiful. So that's the first truth. I'm not going to be able to take that much time on all of them. That's number one. We look at the Son and we see God. The second big idea out of this passage is that we look at the Son and we see all God originally intended in creation. Verse 16, go back one slide, says this. Verse 16, for in him, that is the Son, that is Jesus Christ, for in him all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Now, a whole other sermon, which maybe I'll get to another year. A whole other sermon. What in the world does it mean that in Christ, that all things have been created in him? Verse 16, for in him all things are created. And then toward the end of it, all things have been created through him, and all things have been created for him. We don't have enough time today to unpack that, but just hear that for a moment. For in Christ, all things have been created in Christ. All things have been created through Christ, And all things have been created for Christ. Well, I can't unpack that in all its complexities today, but what I can say simply is that when we look to the Son, we see all that God originally intended in creation. God's purposes in creation and His plan, hear me, His plan for the world's redemption, they're all fulfilled in Christ. What do we know? What do we find in Christ? God's original intention for creation, we know rest, and we know peace, and we know blessing, an existence devoid of worry. No sickness, no sorrow, no crying, no abandonment, no betrayal. When Christ humbled Himself and moved into our realm, what He introduced, what He has brought, is all that God originally intended for creation. Big idea number three out of this passage. Everything finds its purpose in Christ. I was going to pick one verse, but I think all six verses really, really lean heavily into that truth. Everything finds its purpose. That means so do you. You find your purpose in Christ. Now, I will be the first to stand up and say, I struggle with this truth. On my worst days, I doubt this truth. I attempt to find my purpose, my identity elsewhere, but this passage tells us that we find our purpose, our identity in Christ. I was having lunch with a dear friend just a few days ago, just down the street, and I said, man, if you think that pastors don't struggle with an identity crisis or identity crises just like other people do, well, then you're wrong, because we do. Every one of us, regardless of our vocation, our walk in life, what happens is that our job success and our job failures, they make up our psyche. And if you don't have an actual job that pays, whatever you do, because every one of us in this room, we're productive people. We do things. We have output. It goes right back to that partial truth that says that we're merely physical beings. And so what do? We find our purpose, we find our identity in our output. And so there are days where we feel like great about ourselves, but then what happens when we take some time off? We just feel like junk, because our psyche's all out of whack, because we define ourselves in the physical realm, and yet the Christian ethic says your purpose or your identity is found in Christ. I've laid around some this week. Sounds like I've been lounging around, and I don't want to be judged, so we won't say that. But I've been contemplating this week. What if that's true? What if my identity really is found in Christ? And I was thinking about, the death. He died 9 years ago, but I started with Dr. Willard. And I was thinking about, like, I consider him a success in the Christian realm. And published and well-known and brilliant, and yet he died 9 years ago. And his identity is in Christ, because all that other stuff doesn't really matter. Last week's verse said that God has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints. If your identity is in Christ, your eternity and all of the inheritance that God has for you is based on your identity in Christ, not your job, not your physical body, not your ability to produce. Now, I understand that this is cosmic stuff, but what if it's true? If your identity is in Christ, then God has qualified you to share in all the inheritance that he has for you for eternity. Big idea number four. The Son, Jesus Christ, holds everything together. Verse 17, it says that. It says, Jesus, the Son, he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. To this day, if this passage is true, to this day, right up to this very moment, Jesus holds everything together in your life. Present tense. You're being held together by Jesus. You think you're holding it together. And you might say, I'm just barely holding it together, Randy. But you think you're holding it together. We often fall into that lie that, we got it all. Maybe just barely, but I'm holding it together. No, Jesus holds all things together. And hear me, I don't mean this disrespectfully, but I need to say this. When it is time, so Jesus holding all things together in your life, buoying you, holding you up, every breath in your lung, the next thought that you think, he is buoying, holding, keeping you afloat. Jesus is holding it all together. And when it is time for Jesus to pull that thread, and the very fabric of your physical existence ends, then you will move on to the next realm and will exist with the children of God in the kingdom of God forever. I will see many of you there one day. And you'll be like, you preached on this, Randy. And I said, I know. I really believed it was true, or I wouldn't have said it, but I was also really hoping it was true. And it is. And I believe that. I wouldn't tell you that if I didn't believe that. And like you, there are days where that just sounds too good to be true. Could it? Is it? But my hope is in Jesus. And I invite you to place your hope in Jesus. I find this truth. The Son holds all things together. To be so encouraging on another level, and that level is this. I don't have to worry whether or not I'm getting all I can out of life. You know, I don't have to worry about, man, do I have the tiger by the tail? Am I getting it done? Am I accomplishing all that I'm supposed? No, Christ is holding it all together. And where I am by God's grace is where I am in life, because this is where Christ has me. All right, big idea number five. I'm going to have to land this plane here. Big idea number five. Like a head holds a body together, Christ holds the church together. Verse 18. And he, the Son, he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. Like a head holds the body together, Christ holds the church together. That's why he's called the head of the church, and that's why we are called the body. Here's the point. There's a lot of points. This could be a sermon series, but here's the point. This is what we have time for today. The point is, the church is a big deal. In Paul's teaching, in Jesus' teaching, the church is a big deal. And to miss this is tragic. To give the church merely a peripheral position in your life is tragic. I could give you all sorts of examples, but they'd probably be a little bit painful. But to give the church merely a peripheral role or place in your life is tragic. Just wonder silently, am I doing that? Here's another way of saying it. If Christ is the head of anything, then we should want to be a part of that thing. If Christ is the head, the leader of any organization, I want to be actively involved in that organization. We have a lot of freelance, going it their own way, Christians in today's culture. Christ is the head of the body. We are the body of Christ. Last big idea from today's passage. It comes out of verse 20. And here's the big idea. All the broken pieces of humanity get properly fixed and fit together in Christ. All the broken pieces of humanity in this entire universe get properly fixed and fit together in Christ. Verse 20, and through him, through the Son, to reconcile to himself all things, whether the things on earth, the things in heaven, by making peace through Jesus' blood shed on the cross. The Son has come to reconcile. Jesus came, moved into our realm, moved into our neighborhood to make peace between us and him, between you and others also, to make peace in a vertical sense and to bring peace in a horizontal sense through his blood shedding work on the cross. I know when we talk about shed blood for a person who is not yet a Christ follower, it creeps them out a bit. But we must not get away from the fact that Jesus said, this is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. All the broken pieces of humanity get fixed and fitted together in Christ. The Message, Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, says it this way, Colossians 1:20. I think it's the two slides from now. It says this, all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies, all because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. Christ's blood, which we tend to shy away from, Christ's blood shed on the cross was for this great purpose. It really ties back to something that I said earlier when I said that in the Son we see all that God intended in creation. So in closing, now that you have a really good picture, maybe a refresher course for you, now that you have a really good picture of the Jesus of the Bible, hear this. He invites you to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That is my plea this morning. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, or tragically, and yet realistically, you can continue to seek the physical kingdom, and you can continue to seek after what the physical kingdom, the physical world has to offer you, and the choice is yours, and I respect that. But listen, a person is no fool if she trades in the physical kingdom of this world and determines to begin pursuing, seeking the kingdom of God. The world may tell you otherwise, but you are no fool if you choose that path. You are the wise person if you seek first the kingdom of God. Amen. Would you bow and let's pray together. God, we read and we talk about this and it brings a smile to our face. As we wonder and we want for this to be true, as we hope, and yet we ask whether we even dare to hope that this could actually be true. It's so good. And yet, God, I believe that this is exactly what you have for us. This is what is in your word. So God, today we ask that you'd open our hearts. You'd open our hearts to actually be able to believe this. You would take our doubt and you would deal with it and you'd give us a deeper hope in you. God, I pray for us, for me, for many of us in this room today who might dare to seek after your kingdom. Oh God, may we find it in you. May we find it in you.